Welcome to No Crime, No Time Blackout. So this is just like a little share time with you guys. I'm RD, also known as Rubber Ducky. I also have a channel called 1111 Tarot. You can check that out as well. Okay, you guys, I want to talk about what's been kind of like coming to a point where I've got to address it, okay? So what I'm addressing is this whole thing about where was the Rav before the third, right? That got brought up. Well, before I can answer that, I have to bring up something. So when you think of the Rav, all right, automatically, we associate it with it being Teresa Halbach's. And the reason is because she owned the vehicle. It was her first vehicle, right? She drove it everywhere. And so therefore, naturally, her DNA should be everywhere in that car. The only DNA of this victim was blood. We don't have hair. We don't have fingerprints or skin marks or skin shedding by the victim anywhere. We also don't have the alleged assailant, which would have been Stephen Avery, right? So how is that possible? If this was her vehicle, then it got wiped absolutely clean by a professional prior to Stephen Avery's blood appearing in the RAV. Okay? Follow me. This is very important. Because in order to detail and clean that vehicle, you can't detail and clean that vehicle and then the whole scene happen where you get blood in the back and blood on the door and blood all over, because that would imply that Stephen knew how to clean the vehicle, detail it to the point that there is no sign of life in that vehicle, only leave his DNA and the victim's DNA in the car. Clearly visible. So you can't have that. So that implies, because that would not work. So that implies that this vehicle was detailed, professionally cleaned of the victim's DNA after her murder, prior to Stephen's blood appearing in the car, prior to the victim's blood being placed in the car. That's a problem. Because this is supposed to be a cold-blooded murder. So who's the middle guy in between her being alive and Stephen allegedly getting his blood in that car and the victim allegedly being deposited in this car? Who's the middle guy doing the detail work professionally cleaning this vehicle, and why? Also, why are we missing the bolts, the rivets that hold in certain parts of the dash, the cloth parts of the door, you know, the fabric parts of things? Why are we missing those? Where's the cargo mat that's supposed to be laying in the back? And you'd be like, well, you know, that probably got taken out a long time ago. Look at the pictures. It's absolutely clean as a whistle where that mat exactly was. And you can still see the impressions of where it gripped into the carpet. So that's a brand new pull of that. Also, look at the blood spill in the back. Yeah, the blood that actually looks like it was laying there. Yeah, it's interesting because that mat would have had blood on it too, but that's gone. A23. Handprint on the back, the bloody handprint on the back of the cargo door of the RAV4. We know it's not Steve Avery's, and we know it's not the victim. So we have a third party that laid their own blood on the vehicle. Yet we don't know who that is because she couldn't get a good, a good take on it. She could tell you it wasn't Stevens, but I don't know who it is. Well, we know I've got a third party there. Now, let me ask you a question. Over 11 witnesses saw a green RAV4 on Highway 147. The victim's own mother reported it was a dark green RAV4. I actually physically saw the news, the live news bulletins, looking for Teresa Halbach because I'm local. And they showed a dark green stock photo of a RAV4. Out of all the things that is going to help find the victim, it will be her car. And the number one thing about a car to recognize it is the color. Yet we're, end result, have a royal blue, distinctly royal blue, RAV4 in the end. So, if Teresa Halbach had this car for 2 years, would her mother not know the color of it? Yes, she would. And she would damn sure know that if she misled people into thinking that it was dark blue when it was royal blue, that she would reduce the chances of finding her daughter. So she's going to be very accurate. Pam Sturm had a problem. She couldn't find the VIN number. I can't find it. I cannot find it. Well, of course she couldn't find it. If you listen to Wiegert, he testifies, or was it Remaker? One of the two investigators testified that the VIN number had been tampered with and moved. Well, Pam Sturm was a private investigator. She knew exactly where to find that VIN number, yet she could not find it. Now we know. There's your answer. It had been moved. It was no longer in the place that she thought. So why would the VIN number be moved? Let's look at another thing. Those license plates. They would have been new to Teresa. This is her first vehicle, remember? She's so proud. She's had it for 2 years. So we have 2-year-old first time owner license plates. Here's the thing. They're not on the vehicle. They're found in a station wagon on the very edge of the property, like most of the evidence is found on the edge of the property, as if somebody couldn't get onto the property, really. All right? And they're folded into three. And when they unfold them, they've got the front and the back plate. And each plate has 4 holes that you can attach the license plate to a vehicle with. All 4 holes show evidence of an attachment of a bolt with the rusty and the marks. Yet when you look at Teresa's RAV4, her front, where the plate would go, it's only got 2 places that you could possibly attach that plate. So it's almost as if these plates don't align with the blue RAV4. It's almost as if they just put a VIN number there and they just took the plates off and they were like, yeah, this is it, right? Well, let's look at the other side of the coin. I know there's like 14 other million places with the VIN number on this vehicle so that we can double check it, right? Good comeback. The complication isn't that there's not another way to check it. It's who's left in charge of checking it. Sherry Cohen. She's left in charge to verify the legitimate ID of the vehicle. Sherry Cohen's the reason that Stephen went to jail the first time, because she testified him against him in trial, matching that one single hair, saying it was his, and threw him in the clink for 18 years. She's the reason that he's getting out too, exonerated from that crime. Why? Because she was forced to use the new DNA technology that she did not have control of the results of. So she was undoing the web that she had weaved against her will. She had no choice. It was court ordered. She had to do it. The machine was going to pump out the result. She delayed it for a year. And now she's the one left to verify that little floating VIN number and those license plates to match this vehicle. Then, you know, all these years later, we just get really blurry pictures of the VIN. Yeah. It all boils down to, are you sure that this could possibly be her RAV, the victim's? How did Teresa drive it and not leave her DNA?